can start. Yes, got it. Fine. So it's my special pleasure today to welcome Martin Polz to our Planetary Biology seminar series. Martin is on Zoom today, but I should say that he has actually just been in Heidelberg visiting us in person, because since this year, Martin is member of SAC and was here also for the recent DB review. Martin is in Vienna, where he's professor at the Center for Microbiology and Environmental Systems Science, the CMES, but also I think we can say at DOME, the Department of Molecular Ecology in Vienna, a very famous department, since 2020. Before he was for 20 years at the MIT. His research in general is on evolution and ecology of microbes, so with a strong major research focus on genomics and bacterial populations in the environment. So very planetary biology relevant. And at MIT has been chair of the program in biological oceanography and also co-founder of the microbiology program there. Martin is a fellow of the American Academy of Microbiology, where he also received a prestigious prize, and will tell us today about eco-evolutionary dynamics of phage-host interactions in the wild. Martin, thanks a lot for visiting us today, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you so much, Detlef, for the introduction, for the kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to be able to tell you a little bit about our work today. It's fairly recent work on phage-host interactions, and I'm just going to dive right into it with this slide here. If my slide advancement works. Yes, there we go. So most of our work over the years has been in the marine environment. And as many of you know, the marine environment is probably, it's fair to say, the best studied microbial ecosystem. The human gut is very rapidly catching up, but many of the pioneering work was actually done in the oceans. And also some of the early work on the importance of viruses in structuring microbial communities and populations was done in the ocean. And so viruses, we've known for quite a while, are key members of marine ecosystems. And when you go to the surface ocean, for example, and you take a sample, you will find that there's about 10 to the 7 viral particles per milliliter, which is about 10 times more than bacterial cells. So viruses outnumber bacteria by about 10 to 1 on average, although there's quite a lot of variation out there. And it's often said that they control bacterial populations and alter ocean carbon and nutrient cycling through their lytic activity. So they lyse microbes and thereby liberate nitrogen and phosphorus, for example, that's tied up in microbial biomass that's then available for new production. We also know that in general, viral predation is quite specific, and that bacterial populations and communities are extremely diverse out there. And so this supposed killing then is, I think it's a fair question to ask, how can all this killing really happen? And so when we started this work, actually, it was obvious that counting viruses and bacteria doesn't tell us. And unfortunately, sequencing, so metagenomics, doesn't tell us yet, at least, because it's very difficult to actually really link hosts with their specific viruses and infer lysis from that. And so what we reasoned was that we need a high resolution observation of live bacteria and viruses in the environment. And so Catherine Kaufman was a tremendously talented PhD student in the lab, and she decided to take on this problem and really did an amazing piece of work where she constructed a time series where she went out every single day for 93 days in a row and sampled the coastal ocean north of Boston on this peninsula here, this called Nahant, we chose it because it's it really protrudes in the ocean, and there's very little influence of freshwater and coastal runoff, basically. And so what I'm showing here today is really very characteristic of coastal ocean dynamics. She sampled every single day, I said. We collected several size fractions and sequenced marker genes from these. We now also have the time series fully metagenomically sequenced, and I'll come back to that a little bit later in the talk. And amazingly, she archived virus concentrates and microbial cells from each day. So we can always go back and test specific hypotheses that we come up with from the dynamics that we observe. And on 3 days during the time series, she isolated 1,000 isolates of our model system that is called Vibrios, and used these as bait to isolate phages, coexisting phages. And then she did a fully resolved cross-infection matrix that we then fully genome sequenced. And so to my knowledge, this remains, I think, the largest to date fully genome resolved cross-infection matrix for bacteria and their viruses. And so just to talk a little bit more about our model system, the way we isolate them is randomly on culture plates. So what is out there, we have shown over the years that this isolation is quite representative of what's out there. So on these culture plates, we randomly pick them colonies, sequence the genomes. And over the years, so this has been sort of a longstanding interest of my lab, is to really look at population structure of microbes in the wild. And we've developed some techniques to look at recent gene flow, to estimate recent gene flow between bacterial genomes. So by looking at both homologously recombined pieces, but also non-homologously introduced pieces of DNA. And we use this gene flow information to construct clusters. And over the years, we've shown that we think that these really represent sort of eco-evolutionary units out in the wild, or microbial populations, if you will. And I'll come back to this point later. And the important point is that the resolution here is much, much higher than taxonomic species in general. And even though I'm showing here, for example, these gene flow clusters, and they have named species assigned to them, we do this by placing type strains into the clusters. But oftentimes we do find clusters that basically have no named representatives. Okay, so the Vibrios, our model system, random isolation. We tried to do the same thing with phages to get an idea of their relative abundance in the environment. So the way we did this was we participated in methods development where we can collect very large volumes of seawater, precipitate out the viruses with iron chloride. You can then spin it down, this concentrate, and then archive the viruses essentially. And we've shown that the viruses are quite stable in these archives. And then you can go back to these archives, redissolve the viral particles from these precipitates, and then use basically a plaque-forming unit assay to count how many viruses for a particular bacterial strain were present in a sample. And so overall, when we did this, we found a very diverse collection of viruses that represent all the major viral groups, myoviruses, protoviruses, cytoviruses. And then also we found a new type of virus that I'll talk a little bit about in a few slides. As you see, we assigned, you know, genera, and this just gives you an idea that the collection is actually really quite diverse. So the first thing we were interested in using our cross-infection matrix was the question of how specific virus-host interactions are in this system. And so what I'm showing here is an inverted tree of the Vibrios that we obtained overall from our sampling. Again, here's these population assignments, and the colors here on the side correspond to these population assignments. And the dots here represent a virus that was isolated for these organisms. And what you see is that most of the dots are really clustered along the ring, which is an indication that the viruses were very, very host specific, oftentimes infecting a single host or maybe a few hosts that were closely related. There were a few notable exceptions where we had more broad host range viruses. For example, here, these are T4 viruses. They are well known to have broader host range. But then also in orange here is colored a different kind of virus that we saw that had really the most broad host range in our samples. So most viruses appear to be specialists, infecting few strains within single populations, but some are generalists infecting multiple populations. But I want to point out that even these are most of the time very strain specific. So when we talk about broad host range viruses, I think we have to keep in mind that most of the time they're still quite strain specific within the populations. So what was this generalist phage that we found? Turns out it's a really interesting phage for multiple reasons. It's a new type of viruses. They're non-tailed. So most bacterial viruses have these lunar lander kind of morphology with a tail and tail fibers. These do not have that. And interestingly, they also have a membrane that you can see a little bit here on these electron micrographs, in addition to a proteinaceous shell that is kind of unusual for these viruses. But importantly, they actually resemble the morphological majority in the ocean. So people have looked under the electron microscope and they found that most viruses, and when I say most, really 80-90% in many samples of viruses that you can see resemble this morphotype. And so then the question was, of course, why were they never actually isolated? There was a single isolate from the 1960s from the ocean that resembles that morphology, but any other screenings have basically failed to recover them. And so I'll address this question actually in the next slide. Let me just also tell you a few more interesting facts about these viruses. They have very, very small genomes, about 10 kilobase pairs, which is really unusual for viruses. Most phages typically have at least 30 kb genome size, oftentimes 50, and sometimes even several hundred kb in size. And they were only about 7% of the isolates, but represented nearly 40% of the infections. And there's also a prophage version of this virus that was actually known before. So why have people not actually isolated these phages? And it turns out that there were really four factors that conspired against these viruses. The first one is that oftentimes people add chloroform to viral preps to kill contaminating bacteria. But because these viruses actually have a membrane also, they're killed by chloroform. So that is shown in this graph here where plaque forming units are enumerated compared to a tailed virus that is, and the site of our viruses are in gray. And you see that with this one exception here, these viruses are extremely efficiently killed by chloroform. Another reason is that they were not seen was that their buoyancy is different from the tailed viruses, again, because they have a membrane. And oftentimes when people try and concentrate viruses from the environment, there's gradient centrifugation that is being used. And these viruses are lighter and therefore form a very distinct band in these preparations than the tailed viruses. It turns out that in metagenomes, they're also underrepresented. And the reason for that is that they have a covalently bound protein to their DNA. And so when you do a regular DNA prep, their DNA actually partitions with the protein. And so we think that in order to see these viruses, you have to use at least proteinase K. And then finally, they're very slow. When you grow them in culture, they sometimes form plaques only after a couple of weeks or after a week or so. And only because Catherine kept her plates around and looking at them over and over again, did she actually detect these viruses. And so for me, this is actually a very important lesson that I want to stress, how our methods really determine the window that we have on diversity in the environment. And oftentimes we overlook important members of communities because of these methodological biases. When we looked more carefully though, using some iterative searches, we did find a bunch of these viruses. So we think they're actually quite diverse. And I won't go into detail here, but again, there's prophage versions. We did find them in some metagenomes and also in putatively infected microbial cells. Okay, so this new virus is shown in this cross-infection matrix, which is now in a square representation here in this slide. This you see again how unusual in terms of the breadth of infection this virus is. And again, I mentioned that most of the viral infections were highly specific. There was a predominance of single hosts or very closely related hosts. And one other thing I want to actually point out, oh, I see this was from a conference this slide, but there was obviously a poster associated with this. But one other thing I want to point out here is how sparse the matrix is. Okay, most bacterial strains that we pulled out, we could not find a virus for. And so this was an interesting question for us. And we asked basically, why is that? What determines the viral specificity in the wild? And in order to address this question, we basically started to look at a feature in the cross-infection matrix that we thought was an interesting one to basically ask about the specificity, where we found some very, very closely related hosts that were infected by different types of viruses. We had several of those features across the matrix. Okay. So this was this work was spearheaded by Fatima Hussein and Javier Dubert. Fatima just got a job at Tufts University and Javi in Spain. So they've gone off and have their own labs now. But basically to set the stage, let me show you what sort of the literature says about bacterial defense strategies for evading viral predation. There's a long history of looking at receptor modification. So viruses generally recognize surface structures to which they dock, and then they inject their DNA into the cell, oftentimes also through protein structures. And when you throw a phage with a bacterium into a culture tube, what you will immediately select for is these kind of receptor modifications, where the phage then is unable to dock. But recent years actually have seen an explosion of novel defense mechanisms that have been discovered in bacterial genomes. This isn't really even updated now, but we all know about CRISPR-Cas, of course, restriction modification systems. But there's a really tremendous discovery of new systems like abortive infection systems playing a role in defense, novel antiphage defense systems, and so on and so on. And so we know now that there's about 150 different defense systems out there. These discoveries were really precipitated by the work of Rodham Sorek's lab, but many other labs are now also making some really seminal discoveries here. And so Rodham and Odd Bernheim coined this idea that there's a pan-immune system that defends bacteria against viruses, because they saw that there was relatively high turnover of these defenses amongst strains from the same species. And so the question for us was then, what about the environment? What really does determine the specificity? Is it receptor modification or defense genes internally? And so we argued that the dynamics in the wild are actually quite poorly understood. And so again, I come back to this cross-infection matrix, and we decided to map the receptors, identify defenses, and then look at the environmental dynamics of some of these interacting pairs. So shown here is now one of these clusters of these bacterial strains, and they're infecting viruses. And as I mentioned before already, what we found was we had these clusters of extremely closely related hosts. These genomes differ by only 17 SNPs across the core genome, yet they have completely unrelated phage that actually infect them. And so our first idea was that we wanted to map the receptors, which we did by transposon mutagenesis and resequencing of spontaneously resistant mutants. And we found that this orange phage basically uses the general secretion system, the type 2 secretion system for infection, whereas the other phage, the purple phage, has a primary receptor that is the lipopolysaccharide, which is quite common in fact, and then a secondary protein that is necessary for infection, that is a membrane-spanning protein through which the DNA is actually probably injected. And so this is shown here in a model. We think that the putative receptor is the pseudopilin in the type 2 secretion system. And here we have a primary receptor and the secondary receptor for this other phage. Having identified those, we were now able to look at the diversity of these genes in these hosts. And perhaps not surprisingly, given how closely related they are, we found that they were completely monomorphic. There were absolutely no SNPs in these genes, which means then that the phage always can get into the cells and that the defense is actually internal. And so when we went back to our cross-infection matrix and then looked at the genes that have a presence-absence kind of pattern amongst those genomes and clustered these, we saw that we perfectly recapitulated with these clusters the phage infection. So the orange phage infecting the orange strains and the purple phage infecting these purple strains. When we then looked at the genomes, and I want to point out that this really required full assembly of the genomes, because in short reads, these flexible regions oftentimes broke. What we saw was that these strains had mobile genetic elements that differentiated them. And so the orange strain had 3 mobile genetic elements that were specific to it, and the purple strain had 2 mobile genetic elements specific to it. And they are very interesting. They're actually very poorly characterized. Most of the genes, I should say, did not annotate at all. We did find, however, evidence for phage defense genes on them, like restriction modification, toxin antitoxin systems, and so on, along with some other genes that are putatively involved in defense. And these mobile genetic elements oftentimes have integrases as well, which means they engage in site-specific recombination. So they insert in the same region in the genome, oftentimes in a specific host gene, for example, shown here. But when they do that, they actually duplicate that gene that they cut apart. So they don't actually disrupt host function, we think. Okay. So, then to more reductively prove that these systems are actually involved, we took the orange host, one of the orange hosts, and systematically knocked out the 3 systems, the 3 mobile genetic elements in all possible combinations. I don't want to go too much into the details here, but here's the orange wild type, and here's the purple wild type. What you see here is a dilution of the phage, and the number of clearings you see is then proportional to the infection strength in a way, okay? The other thing I want to point out here are some culture plates where we basically try to re-isolate the phage from these clearings of the host. And what you see here is actually that in most cases, we did not succeed in isolating live phages, even though we get clearing. This is a well-known phenomenon that is called lysis from without, where the phage can infect, but the host essentially commits suicide upon the infection. And this is basically why you get this clearing, but get no viable phages. Let me walk you a little bit through it. So we call these phage defense elements. Knocking out phage defense element one gives you no viable phage. We get a little bit more infection. This system has a restriction modification system, whereas two and three have TA systems, toxin antitoxin systems, or at least they're annotated as such. I want to shorten the description here, but what we basically found was that only if you knock out system two and three can you get viable phages. That is because the restriction modification systems are oftentimes leaky and are an imperfect defense. And if you knock out all three of them, you basically get the same type of infection, strength of infection as in the purple wild type. So what this means is basically that the one system provides a first level of protection, we think. This is the restriction modification system, but it's a quite leaky protection, and viable phage can be produced if the infection happens at high concentration or many times over. And PDE2 and 3, which have these abortive infection systems, kill the host. They're sort of this emergency break. But all three systems basically work together to protect against this particular phage. And this, is a feature that we were able to extract from our system because we work with coexisting phages and hosts, essentially. When we zoom out and look at a little bit more diverse strain collections, so here we have our purple and orange hosts, we found that these strains are really full of highly diverse phage defense elements. And we found that a single strain can have up to 12 of these mobile genetic elements. They're fundamentally unrelated to one another. That's shown in this graph here, where this is a gene sharing network. They oftentimes maybe have an integrase that they share, but all the genes are pretty much unique to them. And I think that there's a lot of new classes of mobile genetic elements embedded in this. Importantly, also, they turn over quite rapidly. Strains with no SNP in the core genome sometimes had some different PDEs, basically, or phage defense elements. Even in the time series, and this is actually one of my favorite figures from the paper, we saw that there's rapid evolution at the population level over a mere, I think, 60 days or so of observation. So evolution, the textbook definition is oftentimes that it is a shift in allele frequency within populations. I think for bacteria, because of this strong element of horizontal gene transfer and loss, gene loss, we need to add gene gain and loss from populations, essentially, or shift in gene frequencies. And so what we did to address this question was we developed a quantitative PCR assay, a digital PCR assay, where the assay spans the host genome and the mobile genetic element. And we quantified one purple element and two orange elements. And one orange and purple element perfectly correlated across time series. You see this here in the correlation. That's when you are used to working with environmental correlations, that's an insanely strong correlation, which really suggests to me that we're following the same clonal background, backbone essentially. But then one of the orange elements was at much lower frequency in the beginning, and then only became prominent towards the end of the observation period here. So to my knowledge, this is actually the fastest evolutionary turnover that we've in wild populations that we actually know of so far. And that sort of gives you an indication of how important these dynamics are for the population structure, perhaps. Interestingly also, when you look at the flexible genome of our populations, and I wanna remind you here that we define populations much more narrowly than is usually done, because we think that this is important for particularly important for looking at the flexible genome. because gene presence absence oftentimes signifies frequency-dependent selection. I can talk a little bit more about this if you have questions about this later. But when we actually looked at what portion of the flexible genome these phage defense elements make up, we saw that they make up an extremely large portion of the PAM genome. So the sum of genes, flexible genes within populations. That is shown here in this diagram, where we saw that the defense elements themselves make up about 70%, and the defense genes about 20% of the PAM genome. So we think they are really important force of bacterial evolution here. And because mostly their genes do not annotate, they provide also a strong explanation why the flexible genome is so poorly annotated, or at least a facet of that. We also looked in other bacteria. I just wanna give you a snippet of some of the findings here. Here in Listeria, as well as in Salmonella. And we found essentially the same patterns. In some cases, the phage defense genes are carried to a large extent by prophages, but in most cases, they're actually also carried by these phage defense elements. But again, what you need is collections of very closely related strains that have closed genomes. And so the analysis was a little bit limited because of that. Now, what does this actually mean, this rapid transfer of defense elements? Well, it basically means that traits in the core genome have extremely low linkage with predation. Many of you might know that there's this theory of kill the winner, where phages can basically shift the genotypic composition of bacterial populations or communities by attacking the winner of competitive events. But what we see basically, at least in our system, is that the diversity of genotypes is so great and the linkage so low that we basically do not think that phages can select against specific microbial genotypes. And so this is from a picture from a review that Otto Cordera and I wrote years ago, where we speculated that the receptor genes have extremely high turnover, but actually it's the phage defense islands that have such high turnover that unlink basically traits in the core genome from phage predation. Okay, so the next question I wanna address then is, to what extent phage themselves can interact in this really sparse matrix. And this is, again, the work of Catherine Kaufman and William Chang, who worked at Einstein College of Medicine. And so the reason I'm posing this question is because there's widespread evidence that phage can share genes with each other and are quite recombinogenic. So they can exchange really modules of genes, but also can engage in homologous recombination. And so in our system, we find the same, basically. This is shown in this graph here. Here again is the cross-infection matrix ordered by a method that Joshua Weitz from Georgia Tech pioneered. And you see again the sparsity of the interactions basically, but then when we try to compare to what extent diverse phages actually share genome pieces with each other using 25 MERS that we mapped on them, identical 25 MERS, we saw that there's evidence of widespread recombination even amongst very, very different phages that otherwise do not really share closely related genes with each other. And then of course, we had many examples where we saw, for example, that some phages had the same backbone with no SNPs and then had introduced various genes or exchanged various genes with quite unrelated phages otherwise. So there's really widespread recombination, but the picture doesn't fit very well with this sparsity of the matrix. And so I want to take you back to this population framework that I proposed before, where we define populations as gene flow clusters. And when we did this work, what we noticed very quickly was that it is a way to identify very recent adaptations in these populations that are specific to the populations. In an alignment of the genomes from a population, you can scan basically the genomes and look for regions where you have sort of diversity in all populations. But then oftentimes we chanced upon regions where the diversity was reduced, and it was reduced in a population-specific manner. And what this means basically is that genes have arrived from outside of the population and then swept the population for the most time, for the most part. So it's basically a sign of very recent adaptation or recent positive selection. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is because when we looked at the receptor diversity, we saw that the receptors across these populations, and here's the populations that we looked at, was in all cases much reduced than the genome average, which is shown here in these graphs, and here's the receptor diversity. So that's true for both of these receptors that we identified for the phages, but also for the lipopolysaccharide, which is very monomorphic within populations, but quite different between populations. What this means is that we've sort of really been barking up the wrong tree, at least in these environmental populations, by focusing on receptors, because the receptors seem to be under contrasting selection, under strong environmental selection, perhaps, to be functionally intact. And mutations might not be allowed, so to speak, without loss of function. But it also means that the phage will always get in. Okay. And what, in the context of what I showed you before, that the defense is extremely individualized, you can imagine then that you have these cryptic co-infection events where a phage that can actually reproduce in a particular strain co-infects with a strain that is inactivated by the defense. And this inactivation oftentimes happens by cutting up the phage DNA. And these pieces of DNA are then basically available for recombination. And so what we think is happening is that the absorptive host range is a much, much greater than the killing host ranges, and that therefore these cryptic co-infections are important in the ecology and evolution of phages, because it enables phages to exchange genes very rapidly. And the reason we think this is very important for phage biology is also because there's more and more evidence that phages also have a flexible genome, and that many of these flexible genes are actually anti-defense genes that are shared them amongst these phages. Okay, now the last topic I wanna cover then is how much phage can really influence the abundance of microbial populations. And this is a very preliminary tale that keeps a very large portion of the lab busy at the moment, but currently Nina Bartlau is spearheading this effort. I want to take a step back again and remind you that we tried to be quite quantitative in isolating the phages as well as the hosts. And so we have a fairly good idea what the concentration at a given time point is of the phages and their susceptible hosts. So we basically have these viral concentrates that we directly applied to these bacterial lawns. And the way we isolated them is we used about the equivalent of 15 mils per plate. So, and what we basically found was that within these 15 mils, a large portion of bacterial strains had basically no phages that we were able to isolate. And most others where we had phages had only a single strain, a single phage. And then there were a few that were sort of, we call jackpots, where a single strain had actually quite a lot of phages. So what the lesson from this is that the viral predator load is actually quite low for these vibrios. And the majority of isolates had less than a phage per 15 mL. Many years ago now, we also did work where we tried to quantify genome types of the vibrios in the environment. And we concluded basically that, to make a long story short, that the genomic diversity in samples is so great that genomes almost, we call them like snowflakes. And long story short, you know, we quantified a particular population and then determined the number of identical bacterial genomes, or the genomic diversity, I should say. And we concluded that there was less than one cell per mil with an identical bacterial genome. But importantly, we also found that the genome size varied by about a megabase, even for cells that had very few SNPs across the core genome or identical protein coding genes oftentimes. In light of our newer findings now, we think that this is largely due to different numbers of mobile genetic elements carrying phage defenses. And so the potential host concentration is also very low on average. And so I actually think now I'm tending more and more towards this view that we're actually overestimating the importance of phage in the ocean. And so I want to walk you through this, and please take this as just the back of the envelope calculations that are most certainly wrong, but they're just meant to illustrate a problem that we, I think, are overlooking. So we have very low concentrations of permissive hosts and phages. We think it's on the order of average days, maybe one per mil or so, and we can take this as a sort of a baseline. And if we just use a very simple diffusion model, the probability of infection per day is 10 to the minus 6. Now, this you have to see in light also of the half-life of phages in the sunlit ocean is about 2 days or so because of UV light and various, they can sorb to particles and things like that. And very recently, Debbie Lindell's group from the Technion in Israel came to very similar conclusions for even higher abundant cyanobacteria, that they actually in general have very low infection rates. And so then the question is, when and where do all these infections happen so that we can actually arrive at a phage bacteria ratio of 10 to 1? Well, our cross-infection matrix, I think, gives some clues to that. Again, looking at the matrix, we can sort of adding to these bitmap modules, again, devised by Josh White's group in Georgia Tech. Adding the genomic information to that, we can sort of add a little bit more contents to these modules. So we have these broad host range modules where the phage diversity is low and the host diversity is high. So these phages might be fairly successful even when the hosts are at relatively low concentration. And then importantly, we have these bloom-like modules where the phage diversity is low and the host diversity is low. And then we have these singletons where you have really just an occasional infection. Now, going back to the community structure in our time series, what we noticed very early on when we started looking at the microbial communities is that these coastal systems are extremely dynamic. Every few days, a different taxonomic group is blooming, and these blooms are extremely short-lived. So this is shown in this graph here over the span of our 93 days. And this is shown in a little bit more detail here for a couple of eukaryotic and bacterial populations, where you see that you have these almost daily fluctuations or over very short time periods. And then the amplitude of the fluctuations gets larger over a very limited time period. And when you time average this, you see that you get sort of this cold bloom. And so I think this is just an important lesson how dynamic these um, environmental systems in general are. And a single snapshot gives you just really the community of that particular day. And I'm a strong believer in time series to really figure out what is going on. But importantly, this may be the clue, I think, these rapid blooms and crashes to how viruses actually make it. We were very lucky that also our Vibrios bloomed in a short time span within the time series, where they suddenly became the most abundant taxon in the free living phase, about even roughly 30%. And they rose over a very short period of time from very few percent or fractions of a percent of the total community to extremely high abundance. So we were interested what kind of populations make up this bloom. It turns out it's these two populations called Splendidus and Cyclotrophicus. We determined this by using protein marker gene sequencing. So we developed our own tag sequencing protocol that differentiates the populations. And you see that the first peak in the bloom is dominated by the Splendidus, and then the second peak is dominated by this Cyclotrophicus. So again, I said that this is very preliminary work. We now we sequenced the entire time series with short reads and long reads, basically. And we see now that we indeed find viruses that correlate very well with this bloom that are otherwise completely absent from the time series. And across the time series, we find many examples of these extremely short-lived blooms of viruses that are also specific apparently to other taxa like Pelagibacter or various cyanobacteria, and even eukaryotic viruses. We find these extremely short peaks and short blooms. And so we think basically that you have these almost microepidemics where you have perhaps susceptible genotypes blooming that are then being attacked by their specific viruses. And this is how the viruses reproduce. And our hypothesis is that towards the end of the bloom, we should have a shift in genotypic composition of the bacterial populations towards mostly resistant strains. Okay, with this, I'm just gonna summarize now. So I showed you some evidence that we pulled out non-tailed phages. And I take this really as an example how little we know about the diversity of phages in the environment still. We used a combination of techniques to basically try and map what makes viruses specific for their host. What we showed was that there's really a combination of very broad receptors but rapidly changing mobile genetic elements that carry defense genes that determine the specificity. And we also think that the phages can sort of respond to this by these co-infection dynamics, most possibly within blooms, because we think that the phages are quite diverse within those blooms, as are the bacterial genotypes that are blooming. And then these blooms really allow for microepidemics that I think are really key to understanding how phages survive in the environment. And it might be really these periods when there's really strong interactions with microbial populations and where these viruses really limit the abundance of microbial populations. And again, I leave you with this question that to what extent phages really control bacterial populations, I think is an open question. Even though we state this usually in the introduction of every paper that we write about phages, I think the evidence is actually not really as clear as we think. Okay, so with this, I thank you for your attention. Just to introduce my current group a little bit and collaborators and funding sources. And I'd be happy to take any questions that you might have.
Thank you very much, Martin. Very nice, fascinating insights into environmental biology. Yes, I'm sure there are questions, and I already see one. That is Per, who's first.
Hi, Martin. Yeah, great talk. I learned a lot about viruses. I have a question. I mean, maybe I missed it or so. So you talk about particular fraction and you go deep in, but what about virus against protists, fungi, algae, even animals, etc.? So whole population of viruses. And in metagenomics, you might see them. Do you have any feeling what the fractions are per, let's say, general taxa or so? And what's dominating, I mean, in terms of relative abundance or so? Is this the phages, I mean, even bacteria versus other bacteria? You might have a sort of relative abundances of the species versus the phages. So is there just some gut feeling or general numbers? What is influences an ecosystem most? Because I'm sure if the blooms are coming, there might be also other organismal groups sort of coming with us, and the virus of those as well, etc.
Yeah. No, this is a great question. So I have a student actually still at MIT, Annika Gomez. She's looking specifically into eukaryotic virus dynamics. That was her passion. and so the problem is that the numbers are not. We can't compare easily because she mostly is looking at these giant viruses, and they are concentrated in a particular fraction that is different from the bacterial viruses because they're much smaller. So I can't say in terms of importance. I mean, the host concentration is certainly can be very high for algae, for example. We see evidence also of these really rapid expansions of these algal populations, and then they crash just as fast. And we have correlated viral blooms as well. But then we also find evidence of a very steady production of, so chronic infections probably that has been shown for algae as well. So which one is really more important, I cannot say. But we do find sort of similar patterns.
Martin, I have a question regarding at the end the randomness of the occurrences of both bacteria and viruses, because what you tell us is that first of all they are not that abundant. There's a certain scarcity of especially the viruses, and then there's also a high turnover in dynamics and at the end how they infect themselves. So that looks to me like it is at the end there's a huge randomness in whether they encounter anything at all to infect, and also in their abundances. Is that correct?
Yeah. So I think that's
patient dynamics. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, so it's very hard to even like imagine. First of all, of course, you know, the ocean is huge and everything gets mixed around. So of course makes for a lot of random encounters. But then also this defenses, of course, mean that a large fraction of viruses that infect are being inactivated. And so this is must be a huge thing for viruses as well. So they can infect, but then they're basically killed most of the time. And so, but I think what happens is that you have sort of the chemical conditions change over time very rapidly. And so they induce these blooms in bacterial populations. And I think that these phage defense elements have a high fitness cost. So what you have then is probably, you do have sort of a little bit of this kill the winner type dynamics where you have strains that have not a very strong or high load of phage defense elements, are more successful in a bloom. But they're then they can be infected by the viruses, and then the resistant types come up. So you have these dynamics, these frequency dependent dynamics, essentially. I don't know if that addressed your question completely.
Yes, Flora, you want to go ahead? You're muted.
Yes. Hi, Martin. Thanks a lot for the talk. I was more interested in the last part where you talk about do phages really control bacterial population, and thinking how you plan to tackle this. Can we develop like markers that would compare, I don't know, sinking and grazing and competition and nutrient limitation and phages, and then to quantify all of that within one of your time series, and then really start understanding what controls at least their abundance? I don't know for the evolution side of things, but could that be a possibility?
I think you put your finger right on it. It's an extremely hard question, actually. But so I will say that we have one very intriguing observation. So we did like extremely deep nanopore sequencing on the bloom days. And so we have a good idea what the blooming genotypes are, and we can quantify the flexible genome. At the same time, we have these archived microbial cells. And so when we isolate cells, we get Vibrio splendidus and cyclotrophicus as the dominant populations, but in the isolates, the flexible genome does not match the flexible genome of the metagenomes. But the isolates match actually, the metagenomes match isolates that we got from before the bloom. And so what I think is when you isolate these strains from the bloom days, the susceptible strains are all infected by viruses. And once you throw them onto a culture plate, they simply die. Okay. So what we're trying to do is to really, assemble the genomes now, understand what defenses are out there, isolate the phages that are present. So we created we call it a super host, where we knocked out all defenses. So it's hypersensitive. So we can, in an unbiased fashion, isolate all the viruses from the samples. And then we can sort of reconstitute also the defenses in this strain and see, to what extent the individual defenses can defend against the particular viruses that are present, and whether the strains that are before are more susceptible and so on and so on. So that's kind of the idea. It's hard though, because it's a lot of isolating and a lot of cloning and expression and so on.
Cool, thanks.
Martin, I was fascinated by the autoleukin reader, so that they have so far been overlooked. Is there more to come? I mean, I'm not so familiar with the techniques, but do you expect more surprises or you think your sampling is now exhaustive in a way?
No, I think we have, so in our system, I'm not sure. I mean, it's, you can never know what you don't know, right? But I think people are pulling out interesting and novel phages all the time. I mean, I think that there's a lot to be learned. And also I think that what interests me also a lot is the biology of these phage defense mobile genetic elements, because I think they have their own biology. We have no idea how they get around, what induces them and so on and so on. So I think this is just, it's a battle between mobile genetic elements within bacterial cells, essentially. That's how I view it. And so I think that there is a lot of biology to be learned. Viruses, of course, as well. I'm not sure, but and then also, I mean, I think we ignore RNA viruses completely because of also technological biases. I mean, people are trying to address that a little bit more now, but I think there's also probably quite a bit of diversity out there that we don't know.
Okay. Then thank you very much, Martin, again for a fascinating lecture. I think our hour is already over. We are approaching 11:30. Some of us will have the pleasure to meet you later in the one-on-ones.
Great.
And so for the moment, I think we close the session, and I can say see you later. And thanks again for coming, Martin.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.